Logan's run, the ultimate trip, moves to a new night and into a battle with androids, aliens, and a vicious princess. Logan's run, now on a new night and a new time.
Tomorrow at 8, 7 central and north on CBS.
Vice President Mondale comes to Chicago, and still no suspects in the kidnapping of 8-month-old Mellica Cox. Those stories, sports and weather, coming up next.
Great appliances, great savings at Montgomery Ward. Save $70 on Ward's 2-speed 20-pound washer. 10 cycles handle delicate to permanent press. The matching 20-pound dryer is $20 off. All fabrics dry fluffy and wrinkle-free automatically. Save $100 on Ward's 25-inch solid-state color console TV. With one-button color, twin speakers, and light sensor, which automatically adjusts picture to room light. Save now at your Appliance Value Center, Montgomery Ward.
Okay, Sue. Good luck with your exams.
Thanks, Daddy. Let me talk to Richie, okay?
Hi, Klutz.
Hi, weirdo.
How's Cindy Borick?
I hate Cindy Borick.
That's not what I heard.
Keep in touch by long distance. By dialing direct and calling after 5 p.m. weekdays, you can save up to 35%.
Well, anyway, say goodbye to Mom and Dad. And Richie, I miss you.
I miss you too. Klutz.
Evening long distance, one of the few real bargains left.
Oh, it's nice to have First Federal nearby. First Federal of Chicago nearby. It's nice to have First Federal nearby. First Federal of Chicago nearby.
You don't have to go far to get all the services of Illinois' largest savings and loan. There's probably a First Federal of Chicago right near you.
It's nice to have First Federal nearby. First Federal of Chicago nearby.
Channel 2, Chicago.
Harry Porterfield and Bruce Roberts with the Sunday night edition of Channel 2 News.
Good evening. Vice President Walter Mondale came to Chicago late this afternoon on the last leg of a trip to get support for the Democratic Party. Mary Laney reports.
It's been a busy 3 days for the Vice President and Air Force Two. Since Friday, they've jetted to Los Angeles, San Francisco, Topeka, Kansas, and this evening, Chicago. But the Vice President appears to be unruffled by the agenda. He's drumming up financial support for the Democratic Party, particularly support from Jewish donors who've been offended by the administration's stance to allow Palestinians to take part in the Mideast Geneva peace talks.
As we proceed through those negotiations, we are not going to force the Israelis to accept conditions that they don't wish to accept, and we will do nothing to undermine the state of Israel. And I think as our position becomes clearer, many of those original concerns have disappeared. In any event, we have to pursue foreign policy based on what's in this nation's interests and in terms of justice and not on ticket sales.
From Midway Airport, it was on to the Polish-American dinner at the Conrad Hilton Hotel and more politicking with Mayor Bilandic, Senator Edmund Muskie, Congressman Dan Rostenkowski. A short speech, and then on to another cocktail party and dinner at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, shaking hands and politicking with Cook County's financial and political bosses. And tomorrow, there's more politicking ahead for the Vice President. He'll attend Catholic Mass at Our Lady of Pompeii Church, walk to Arrigo Park, where he'll lay a wreath at the Statue of Columbus, and from there, he's going to march in Chicago's Columbus Day Parade. From the Mondale Party at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, Mary Laney for Channel 2 News.
Police are still hunting tonight for two men and a young woman who kidnapped 8-month-old Mellica Cox from her Southside home Friday night. Babysitter Celestine McGill watched in horror as the three took the child at gunpoint and threatened the child's life. The babysitter says she was tricked into opening the front door by a woman who claimed she was delivering a package to the Cox residence.
I opened the screen door to receive the box from her, and at this time, the two guys that were on the side, I guess, they forced their way in with guns. They had a gun at my head.
I just want them to take care of my baby. She's a special baby. She's a vegetarian, and she eats certain kinds of food and drinks a certain milk. And just to take care of her, and just if they're not going to give her back, if they're going to keep her or whatever, just take care of her.
Police say they think the girl was kidnapped because Cox owes someone a gambling debt. The child is being held for payment. The FBI has been asked to join the search. Chicago police are now looking for a man about 45 years old in connection with the beating death of 16-year-old Deborah Rosenkrantz. Police made the sketch of a man known only as Cowboy for the hat he wears after hours of questioning Deborah's friends. Several of them testified they saw a man fitting Cowboy's description force Deborah into his car the day she disappeared and was later left for dead. A Southside woman was killed early this morning when fire gutted her home at 3649 South Giles Avenue. An arson investigation has been ordered to find the cause of the fire that killed 68-year-old Ethel Jones in her first-floor bedroom. Mrs. Jones lived by herself in the two-flat building. Well, Chicagoans who haven't seen their new property tax bill yet are in for a double shock the next time their bills come due. Not only are the assessments going to be higher, the tax rate is going up as well. The Civic Federation today estimated the average tax bill will be as much as 3.8% higher, or a total of as much as $9.11 for every $100 of assessed valuation. That means a tax increase in the average home of about $29. Well, coming up, Bruce Roberts with the exciting American League playoff action and football highlights.
WLS Music Radio is sending 100 very lucky listeners on a dream come true vacation to Walt Disney World in sunny Florida. They'll fly on Eastern, the official airline of Walt Disney World. And once there, they'll be treated to full resort accommodations, sailing on a sparkling blue lagoon, championship golf courses, swimming, and much, much more. To enter, just pick up your WLS game card at a participating Chicagoland Sears store and listen to WLS for details.
Searching for savings? This Monday, discover Evans' one-day Columbus Day Coat Spectacular with 20 to 40% savings. Hundreds of coats from Chicago's premier collection. $140 shearling jackets, just $88. $159 leather coats, reduced to $99. $150 scarf coats, just $108. Buy now. It's a one-day Columbus Day Coat Sale, happening Monday only at Evans, downtown and suburbs.
With a big baseball playoff story, here's Bruce Roberts. Bruce?
And, Harry, it'll be the Yankees and the Dodgers in the World Series as tonight. New York won the deciding game in the ninth inning. The Royals scored two in the first with a man on. George Brett knocked one to right. Mickey Rivers couldn't make the catch. It rolled to the wall. Hal McRae came around from first with a run that made it 1-0. And Brett tried for third. He came in hard, upset Nettles, and that precipitated this. Both benches cleared, but outside of a few blows exchanged between Brett and Nettles, things quieted down quickly. Nobody was thrown out. Brett later scored on an infield out. It was 2-0 KC after one. In the Yankee third, Thurman Munzer the batter. He sent one to right. This single brought in the speedy Rivers from second base, and it was 2-1. The Royals got that run back in the bottom of the frame when Al Cowan singled in Hal McRae, 3-1 after three. The way it stood in the eighth, when Reggie Jackson, who was benched tonight, hit this pinch single to center, it was trapped by Otis. Willie Randolph came in. It was 3-2. And then the ninth, where the Yankees won it. Mickey Rivers singled to right. Paul Blair came in. It was tied at three. Another came in on a sacrifice fly. 4-3, still another on a throwing error by Brett. Rivers scored on it, made it 5-3 the way it ended. So much for baseball. In today's pro football action, the Chargers a winner. Pastorini sprained his ankle. Terry Bradshaw broke a bone in his wrist in the Houston win over Pittsburgh. The Broncos over the Chiefs and the Bengals beat the Packers. In the second quarter, Green Bay's Lynn Dickey threw this 14-yard TD to Barty Smith. The super catch made it 7-0 Packers. With 19 seconds left till halftime, Kenny Anderson, who was 15 of 20 for 190 yards, to Isaac Curtis, 7-7 at the half. That's the way it stood in the third when Tony Davis scored from the two and a later field goal ended it. The Bengals 17, Green Bay 7. In a game played in a driving rain, the Patriots shut out the Seahawks as Steve Grogan threw for three TDs. The first one to Don Hasselbeck as New England gains their first shutout in 3 years, 31-0 over Seattle. Burt Jones passed for four TDs and the Colts come from behind win. This 19-yarder to Raymond Chester came with the Colts behind by 11, made it 28-24 at halftime. Then in the third quarter, it was Jones on a 34-yard touchdown pass to Don McCauley to put Baltimore ahead for good. The Colts a winner, 45-28. Now for the story of the Jets' win over Buffalo. Joe Ferguson hit Lou Piccone on a four-yard first quarter TD, 7-0 Bills. It was 10-7 Jets in the third when Richard Todd threw to Jerome Buckham, 17-7 Jets. In the fourth quarter, Ferguson on his second TD pass of the day, a five-yarder to Bob Chandler, 17-14. It was 17-17 when after a Jet fumble recovery, Clark Gaines ran for 14 as the Jets won it 24-19 despite a 122-yard performance from O.J. In the Raider win over the Browns, Mark Van Egan went over the 100-yard rushing mark. He scored two TDs. This is first. Errol Mann added four field goals as Oakland won their 17th straight regular season game, beating Cleveland 26-0.
Be allowed to land in a number of U.S. cities. But he left the final decision up to the cities themselves. At an airport like O'Hare, it appears it's not going to get a warm welcome. But the sound of a Concorde is four times louder than this. Mayor Michael Belandic doesn't like it for that reason, and neither do the residents around O'Hare. The issue is noise.
SSTs now flying are up to four times louder than new subsonic jets, but communities near O'Hare have long complained that noise from even the conventional jets is deafening. So in those areas, today's decision was met with outrage.
The British and the French brought pressure to bear upon them. I think both of those countries have somewhat of a flying white elephant on their hands, and they're intent on making it pay.
Under the decision, SSTs in service would not have to comply with federal noise regulations. They wouldn't be permitted to fly over the U.S. at supersonic speeds, and they couldn't operate from 10 at night to 7 in the morning. French officials say that those restrictions are outrageous, but SST critics said today that the restrictions do not go far enough.
I find it a very poor compromise and very poor public policy to say to the French and British plane that they can land a plane that makes more noise than any American-built plane would be allowed to make and land at O'Hare. If this is a compromise, we need to go back to the drawing boards.
There are no restrictions on where the Concorde can land. That choice remains with local authorities. As for O'Hare, well, today, Mayor Belandic virtually ruled out any Concords coming here. This has been...
And the General Accounting Office just yesterday released a report saying that the supersonic transport cannot meet the standards that have been set by the federal government, either in their present form, nor could they be retrofitted.